We had a great turnout for our town hall meeting recently, and it was so great that I couldn't answer all the questions during the 1 hour time frame. So I'm going to do it now. And I want you to know that we will continue to do these town halls at least through the summer on the last Saturday in the month. So be there. I want to see you. Okay, on with the first question. The question is, in doing some type of a speed workout, interval workout, are the walk breaks included in the total amount of time? This is actually an option. If you want to get a little bit more distance or some more steps in that workout, you could include them in the, you could actually make them just the workout itself, and you could add the extra steps in the walk breaks. But if you wanted, the bottom line is to just get that minimum amount of time, which could include the walk breaks. It's totally up to you. The question is, let's say that you have a workout of 4 times 1 mile. Do you include walk breaks or put walk breaks in those 1 miles? Yes. What I recommend is that you figure out on the Tuesday workouts, usually is the right day, what run, walk, run you're going to be using in your race. During the mile repeats, run the amount that you plan to run in the race, but walk only about half of that amount. That makes it doable to achieve that faster time on the mile repeats that you need, and it also makes the workout a little harder than the race will be, so you're going to feel better during the race. Am I still recommending a 30-second interval? Absolutely. As a matter of fact, that has become one of the ratios that has the widest range of applicability. We have people that run below 4 hours in a marathon or below 2.5 hours. And we also have people running 15, 14, and 13 minutes per mile using the 30-30. Try it out and do some pacing half miles or quarter miles and figure out what works best at your pace. But that's a good generic way to start, 30-30, and then improvise from there. What are my thoughts on heart rate zone training? Well, actually, during a lot of consultations with my e-coach clients, I've found that those that come in with heart rate monitors don't often use them anymore because of the magic mile and the adjustment of run, walk, run, and all of the ways that we can set up a training program in the Galloway program, most folks don't need it. Now, if you want to use a heart rate monitor, then you need to realize that it is not going to pick up your heart rate drift in the beginning of a long workout, speed workout, or a long run. So you can actually go too fast in the first part of a long run and a speed workout, even though your heart rate is not being elevated. So our guidelines that we have in my books and on the website and in our Galloway training programs are better for holding you back and keeping you under control in the early part of those workouts. Okay, we have a person who is 15 pounds overweight and has tried run, walk, run, but is very tired. The usual reason for this is that the amount of running is too much, or the speed of the running portion is too fast. So I would recommend starting with only 5 seconds, 10 seconds, or no more than 15 seconds as a run segment, and then following up with a 15 to 30 second walk break. And after about 5 minutes of doing that intro, you should not be breathing heavily. If you are, then you adjust downward to running 5 seconds and walking 30 seconds. And that usually brings everything back. If it doesn't, walk for 2 to 3 minutes and then start with 5 seconds running and 30 seconds walking. And then improvise from there, staying away from huffing and puffing. That's your natural heart monitor, and it tells you that you're exceeding your speed limit. I have a question from someone who is really missing running with the group. And it's rampant these days. We will come back to group running, but right now, running virtually is something that we're going to have to do. Some people actually carry a phone with them and have conversations along the way. Others have some other handheld devices that allow them to share their run with another and vice versa. But the bottom line is that a growing number of services are being provided. One of them is Charge Running, which has workouts, live workouts, coached by a coach. And you can be led along, and you'll be sharing that workout with a number of other runners, even though you're running where you are by yourself. So it's a safe way to have a group run. The Yeti Challenge, 5 miles every 4 hours for 24 hours. Well, like a lot of these challenges, the first question is, are you ready to do that? Have you been preparing yourself by running similar workouts during one 24-hour period, in which you could gradually build up every 4 hours? Start out with 1 or 2 miles and gradually build up to that amount. The bottom line is that a lot of people do get injured when they have not prepared for things like that, and then they're not able to run for a while. I have a question about how do you prepare for a race that drops 2,000 feet in elevation from start to finish in a half marathon? Well, it's difficult to do that because there are very few places where you can simulate such continuous downhill and in some cases fairly steep downhill. But if you can find a downhill segment of at least half a mile, you're on the right track and you can go out and do some of your moderate runs, running, jogging and walking up the hill and running and walking down the hill. On the downhill stretches, a lot of people at first do not take walk breaks. And if you're used to taking walk breaks, that's a mistake. You really should continue to take your walk breaks at least through the first half of a downhill race. And if you have run the distance 3 weeks or 2 weeks before your race, at least 14 miles, then during the second half, you could run a little bit more and walk a little bit less. The form is really important on downhill. You want to keep your feet low to the ground. You want to have a light touch of the foot, and you can't let your stride length get too long because that will really pound you, and it will also cause you to use your quads, and they will be very sore afterwards. If you'll follow my form with feet low to the ground, light touch, and relatively short stride, the quads don't have to get aggravated. The question is about the speed of a walk break. What should that be? Fast, slow, in between? Now, normally you need to realize that you need to go at a walk speed that allows you to recover from the run. That is the number one priority of a walk break. Now, after you've gotten the rest speed of the walk down, if you want to pick up the pace of the walk break, then you can practice that on your short run days. And the best way to do that is to work on picking up the cadence of the walk and not the stride length. Actually, a long stride length on a walk is a major cause of injury, even more prominent than running injury. So keep the stride relatively short, pick up the cadence, and you can speed up your walk break. Should you speed up your walk in your walk break to a race walk, or should it be just a normal walk? Race walking carries with it a very high injury risk. The studies on injuries among race walkers show that it's a much higher injury producer than just an average running program will produce. So I don't recommend race walking. It's an abnormal range of motion and it does aggravate a lot of body parts. So find a walk pace that is enough, slow enough to allow you to recover from the run portion. But if you want to speed it up, then you can work on the cadence of that walk break. I have a question from a novice runner who is training for the first marathon. The bottom line is that you need to focus on setting up your long runs, count back from the marathon date, and every 3 weeks, schedule a long run. It's best to go up to 26 miles as your very last long one 3 weeks before, then subtract 3 miles from that every 3 weeks. So you go back 3 weeks and do 23, back another 3 weeks and do a 20, and so forth until you reach 16 miles when you can go down to 2 miles every second week. In between, you only need to run 30 minutes every other day. So the long runs are crucial for building marathon endurance, and they can be as slow as you want to. As a matter of fact, you could actually walk all the distance of the long one, and you would get all the endurance based on the distance that you cover. And if you get all the way up to 26 miles, there's very little likelihood you're going to hit the wall, because you have run to that wall and you are ready to do the event. So any questions? We do have a number of one-hour classes and individual consultations that I am giving. So go to jeffgalloway.com, and I'd love to see you.